congratulations on Ninja Turtles. What is the one thing you guys needed to nail in order for this film to work?
The tone. Without a doubt, the hardest thing with this movie was not shooting, was not technology, was the tone. Getting the tone right. That is what we struggled with for the, you know, for years.
What qualities define this film as a 21st century film?
Well, I think it's the integration of the technology with the characters and being able to make a film where your five leads really are computer generated. I mean, we certainly had actors playing them, but what the audience is seeing is not the actors who played the roles. They're characters that were created in a computer, and at the same time we have actual people integrated, you know, interacting with them. And I don't know that could have ever been done before.
And which was not shot on green screen or blue screen.
Right.
I mean, you know, the movie was filmed on location, and we had our actors in their motion capture suits on the streets of New York or on sets. You know, it was not a green screen movie, and I think, you know, the advances in the technology allowed for all of that. The technology is the reason the movie exists today. Without the technology, I don't believe the movie gets made. I mean, they made a great movie in 1990, and, you know, the Jim Henson, you know, the puppet suits, and there would be no reason to make that version of the movie again. But because of the technology on Planet of the Apes and Lord of the Rings, you know, that is the reason that I think we were lucky enough to get the Turtles on the screen in 2014.
But what extent do things such as brand recognition and ready-made markets and a formulaic blockbuster template play into the success of a film such as this?
Well, I think that's a double-edged sword because, fortunately or unfortunately, depending on how you look at it, everyone comes to the Turtles with a different set of knowledge. There are people like myself who love the 90s films and Drew loved the comics, and then some people watch the animated shows. And that's hard because all those people are coming to the movie to see the things that they enjoyed in their youth, and we're not going to be able to serve all those four different you know, source materials. So what we did is we utilized the time and brain of Kevin Eastman, who created the whole thing, to kind of help us get through a storyline that integrated all of those four different source materials into what the movie is now.
I really want to know just a bit more about getting the tone right, what you wanted to do, and I guess more particularly, what you wanted not to do with this film.
Well, I think that it was important to us primarily that the film was a fun family experience to go into the theater, and like a ride. We wanted it to be like a ride. And the integration of humor is a very huge, you've seen the film, it's a large component of that. And when you make a movie that has this many, you know, computer-generated characters, you don't have the ability to test the movie, put it in front of an audience, and see how your jokes are playing, really. You kind of just go on your gut and hope that it's right. And that's a very daunting process. In a normal process, on all of our other films, we test them 10 times in front of an audience. We know exactly how the audience is going to respond to many of the things. And this was like the first time that we were kind of flying blind.
For the record, could you please confirm once and for all that if Megan Fox was a crap actress, you would have used someone else?
Well, we know that she's not a crap. You're right. If she was a crap actress, we would have used someone else. But we know for a fact that she wasn't. Bay had used her in two of his films. Michael's our partner, so we were, you know, we didn't just see the movies, but we were in the edit room. We saw what they weren't using, what they were using, and we were, you know, we know that she's talented, and that's why she was the only person we went to play April O'Neil.
And by the way, you're also right, Jim. It is extremely difficult to act in this movie. I mean, Megan has to act each scene 3 different times, once with the guys in the motion capture suits, once without the guys, and then, you know, and do the entire scene alone. So it's really, really hard.
You guys specialize in remakes. Just firstly, explain to us the appeal of remaking famous movies.
It was never our intention to become a company that remade other people's properties. You know, our first movie worked out very well for us, and we followed it up with another remake, and suddenly that kind of became a path that we were going down. But, you know, we've made a couple original, you know, like The Purge is a film that we made that's original. I mean, we've made other original films. But I think in the current climate right now, that if you're able to have a property that has a built-in audience, that makes the studios feel more comfortable to spend more money because they know that there's a core audience that's going to go, that's going to attend the movie on the opening weekend. And then you have to follow it up with a good movie so they keep coming.
Why do people want to see well-known stories retold?
Well, sometimes I think the reason that the stories are well-known is because they're things that, you know, are in our DNA. I mean, if you want to talk about the Turtles, I think the reason that the Turtles, that you can keep on doing different versions of the Turtles and they seem to work is because the theme of the movie is family and brotherhood, and that's something that every single person on this planet has some relationship to, so they all see something in the Turtles or in Splinter that they can relate to. So it feels like that's why that's this particular story has had the longevity that it has.
Guys, in the interests of assuring everyone that you two are not, in fact, the movie Antichrist, because movie remakes and sequels are always cited as being corrosive elements in cinema culture.
Thank you.
Can you just reassure us that you are, in fact, do not mean cinema culture any harm and that you are looking to do more original work?
I will take it one step further. You know, we just want to entertain people, and we want to do original stuff, and we want to, you know, and what we do is when we are confronted with something to potentially make, we ourselves have to be excited about making it, and we are fans of it first. It's not like we didn't love the original Texas Chainsaw when we made that movie. We just thought that there was maybe a different way to tell the story, and as you know, in all art, there's evolution. And we just are the guys who are currently carrying the torch for whatever property we're working for, and other people will carry it after us, and hopefully some of the things that we've done that are original, I would be delighted if 10, 15 years down the line, there's someone else doing Purge movies, and they're using our films as the basis for those remakes.
You guys have made very, very successful films on low budgets that have made a lot of money. The Turtle movie is very, very successful, as have been all the Transformer films. Every single one of them have been hated by critics. What do you think this huge disconnect between film critics and audiences says?
We should do a whole other show on that. But, sometimes the critics are going to the movie and looking for one thing, and I think audiences simply want to go and be entertained. We believe that when an audience goes to a horror movie, that if you scare them enough, that's an entertaining experience. And likewise with the Turtles, if you go there and you laugh and you have a good experience with your family, that's a great experience, and that's why people go to the movies. That's not necessarily what critics are looking for in the film, so that's, I think, where the disconnect is.
Now, 3D. Guys,
yep.
When are we going to give up 3D? Please.
Okay, I get it. But listen, we didn't make the film in 3D. The film was converted afterwards. So we just wanted to make the best film that we could. And, you know, the way that these films are marketed in different countries in 3D, you know, in America, you can watch it in 3D or not. So it's a choice, and the audience makes the choice. We aren't insisting on it.
Right. In Australia, we don't really test screen movies very much at all, whereas in America, it's part of filmmaking culture. What are the benefits of test screening, and do you recommend that we adopt test screenings?
I can't recommend that someone adopt test screening. I can just tell you that having been at over probably 150 tests or something like that, watching your movie with an audience and having them have an organic response to what you've made has been the single most important thing after you pick a director and a script in our films working or not working, because when you hear the organic response to what you're doing, it gives you an opportunity to either fix it or enhance it, and that has proven very helpful to us.